Hi everybody, welcome. Thank you for coming to my session. We're going to talk about cryptography today. My name is Michel Schudel. I'm a Java developer from the Netherlands working at a company called Craftsman. We do all kinds of cool projects for banks, insurance companies, Dutch Railways, and so on. And a hobby of mine has always been looking for new things. And in 2 years ago, I started with dealing in crypto coins. So how many of you also have dealt with crypto coins or have some crypto coins? A few of you, yeah. So it made you a ton of money, right? No, me either. Oh, yeah. Oh, one. Okay. Well, I didn't get rich from it, but I was really interested because I was logging into this cryptocurrency exchange using HTTPS and then executing some transactions. And I was really interested in how does this all work cryptography-wise. So this is not normally something you deal with on a daily basis as a Java developer, but it's really interesting to see how this actually works, what the concepts are, and how to do this in Java. So that's what I'm going to tell you today. So the takeaway today is a basic understanding of cryptographic concepts and how they're done in Java, right? So this is for beginners or novices, or if you want a refresher, that's fine by me as well. But we'll start at the basics. So what is cryptography? Cryptography, you can look it up in Wikipedia, is basically the practice and study of hiding information. That's all there is to it. And it's been around for a long time as well. So anybody knows what this is? This stone? Rosetta Stone, yeah, exactly. So it was dug up in, I think, maybe 1969, I don't really know. But it had ancient Egyptian hieroglyphs on it and also ancient Greek, which people could read. So they could use this to decipher the message that was written in hieroglyphs. The Romans used this as well. They used a simple cipher. So A becomes C and D becomes F. You all know this scheme, right? And the key in this case was 2 or 3 or 4, the number of shifts. And each legion had a different key. So it was a very simple way of hiding information. And also, it's in the Kama Sutra. So there is a section in the Kama Sutra on cryptographic functions as a means of communication between lovers. So if you were questioning cryptography is sexy or unsexy, I proved you wrong, right? So, anyone know what this is? The Enigma machine, yeah. It was used extensively by the Germans in the Second World War to encrypt and decrypt messages. It was cracked by Alan Turing and his team, and it has been said to have shortened the war by 2 or 3 years. So very important achievement by Alan Turing and his team. So if we look at modern cryptography, what does it actually solve? Well, it actually solves 3 things. So it first tries to solve the problem of confidentiality. So I send a message to someone and no one really knows what the message is. The second part is integrity. So a message, you should be able to see if a message has changed or not, or trying to prevent that. And the third is authenticity. So if I send a message, can the receiving party actually determine if I am who I say I am? There are 3 concepts in contemporary or modern cryptography that try to solve this message, these concepts, these problems. The first one is symmetric encryption, where in this case, an example, we have 2 participants, Alice and Bob, who want to encrypt messages to each other, and they use a shared key. So how this key is shared will come on later in a little bit. This is symmetric encryption, so they both use the same key to encrypt and decrypt messages. The other one is asymmetric encryption, where basically Bob gets a public key from Alice, private key she keeps for herself, and Bob can use this public key to encrypt messages, send them to Alice, and Alice can use her private key to decrypt the message again, and vice versa. But it doesn't work if you try to encrypt or decrypt a message with the same key. So you cannot encrypt and decrypt the same message with the same public key, for example. That doesn't work. And the last one is hashing, which we're going to talk about. So most of you probably have used hashing before. So it's basically having an arbitrary sequence of bytes or a piece of text and generating a fixed length binary value. So let's look at how this is implemented in Java. So there are two concepts in the JDK. JCA, which is Java Cryptography Architecture, and JCE, which is Java Cryptography Extension. The original idea was that JCA was the API and JCE was the implementation of Spec, but they're now kind of mixed together, so we'll just use them as one right now. So if you look at the architecture, if you have a Java application that uses cryptographic functions, you send a request to the API, which is JCA or GCE, and then you proceed to use a cryptographic service provider, so it's a pluggable architecture. Now, if you download the JDK, the SunGC is already in there, and it can perform a lot of cryptographic functions. But if you really want some fancy and advanced stuff, you need a third-party cryptographic service provider, for example, Bouncy Castle or another CSP. It doesn't really matter. So you can plug them in as you go. So how you can plug them in? There is a security class in Java which has a static method. It's called addProvider. And you can use this to plug in your own specific security provider, which has to extend the abstract class provider. This is one way to do it. You can also use it by registering it in the Java security file. So here's a list of security providers, and you can just plug it in the last row, and it will be fine. Now, between Java 8 and JDK 9 onwards, there's a little difference. So the Java security file is in a different location. That's one you have to worry about. And the other one is the library extension mechanism from Java 8 has been removed in Java 9. So that means you have to put your security jar or your security provider on the class path instead of this extension mechanism. So that's something to look out for. Now, here's a list of a few classes we're going to see today. Not everything, but to give you an impression of how complex this API is, most of the stuff you want to do with cryptography in Java, you use these classes. So it's like maybe 10 or 12 or something like that. So we're going to see a few of these classes in a moment. So what we're going to cover today, we're going to cover hashing, symmetric encryption, asymmetric encryption, digital signatures, which are really important, and also a little bit about certificates and certificate management. Okay? So we'll start with hashing. So hashing is nothing more than taking an arbitrary message or sequence of bytes and putting them through this, well, let's say this big meat grinder, right? And out comes a byte array or a value with a fixed size, which is called the digest. So we'll look at applications in a few moments, but first we'll look at some properties of hashing. So the first one is, it's one way. So if you have an input string or an input byte array, you put it to the function, you get a digest, but you cannot reverse this. That's one. It's deterministic. That means if you put the same input string to the hash function again, out comes the exact same hashing digest. Third is fixed size. It doesn't matter how big the input is, the digest will always be a fixed size. And the fourth is pseudo-random. So that means if you change just one letter, so here I made a change from V to W, to U, out comes a cryptographic digest that is completely different. So it's pseudo-random, there's no pattern there to be discovered. And this property is actually used in Bitcoin mining, as we will see in a few moments. What are the chances that two completely different inputs will give you the same hash value? Well, the collision chance now has been calculated that this will occur once in every 10 to the power 13 years. So if you imagine that the age of the universe is actually 13.7 times 2 to the power 9, this will take quite a while, so don't worry about this, okay? What algorithms are there? There's an algorithm which is called MD5. It has a hash size of 128 bits, but don't use this anymore. In 1997, a few guys succeeded in creating 12 different PDFs, all with the same hash value at the end. So this is a collision, don't use this anymore. So what we use today is, for example, SHA-1 and SHA-256. I have no idea why SHA-1 is called that, because it has a hash size of 160 bytes. And I understand the second one, but I'm going to give a demo of SHA-256 in a moment. So how is this done in Java? Well, there is a class called MessageDigest in the JDK, which you can use, and there's a static function on that. It's called getInstance, and you can specify the algorithm you want. So, for example, SHA-256. Then you can put your message in that with a method called digest, and out comes a hash. So nothing to it, it's as simple as that. So I'll show in a quick demo. Is this readable from the back? Yeah, okay, thanks. So I have created a function here, it's called hash text. And you see here, I use the message digest class and I use it to get an instance. I have an input here. Okay, so this is a function. There's a little bit input here. I get the bytes from that. Then I call a digest on this message digest class to digest the input, and out comes a hash. And I have created the examples that you saw in the slide before. So I'm going to run this. And I hope this is big enough. So you see one way only, and then deterministic. So this is the same string as the string above. It's the same hash. It's pseudo-random, so I made a typo here. And you see the hash is completely different. And it's also fixed length. So I have a lot more text here, but the hash is still the same length. Okay, so these are some properties of a hash in practice. Let's see. Where was it? So, an application of hashing, for example, is password hashing. So, if you log into a site securely, you never store plain text passwords, or even better, you don't store passwords at all, you just store a hash of a password. So, this is how this works. You have a plain text password when you create a new account, you put it to the hashing process, and you store the hash in the database. And the other way around, if you log into the site again, you take the plain text password from the login form, you put it to the hashing process, and you compare it to the stored hash that was already in the database. Now, there's one thing. You can hack this using, for example, what is called a rainbow table, which is basically a dictionary of all English or Dutch or whatever words which are pre-hashed, and you just can compare or try all these different kind of hashes against the words. So one way to combat this is using a salt, which is basically a random sequence of numbers that you add to your plain text passwords. You don't have to do this yourself. The website does it for you. It will store the salt and the hash together. And if you do a password verification, the user inputs his password, you take the salt from the database, you stick them together again, you calculate the hash from that, and then you see if they match. So this is a way of combating, for example, brute force attacks with big pre-calculated hash tables. So this is one application. The other one is Bitcoin block mining. So maybe you've read this, but the Bitcoin energy consumption right now, relative to several countries, is, for example, now 90% of the total power consumption of the Czech Republic. So this is continuous. Why is this? It's because of this hashing function. What Bitcoin has is an agreement in the specification, which is called mining, is that the hash of a block should start with a number of zeros. And this number of zeros become increasingly more as time progresses. This is part of the specification. So I've made a simple example here. What they do is they say, OK, a hash of a block should start with four zeros. So we say, I have a Bitcoin block here that has two transactions. And this is a blockchain that gives kudos to conferences, for example. I have two transactions here. And of course, DevOps is better than JFocus, so I don't have any. I hope nobody from JFocus is here. And I'm going to calculate, I have a random number there, and I'm going to calculate a hash from this. So SHA-256, and it doesn't start with four zeros. So what I now do is increment this random number, and I calculate the hash again. So no four zeros yet. And you can imagine, since this is pseudo-random hashes, you cannot predict if it will start at four zeros. There's no way you can take a shortcut. You have to just hash again and again and again. So I increase it again to random two. And now I calculate a hash and it starts at four zeros. So according to the Bitcoin specifications, this is a valid block. And of course, this is easy to verify because you only have to calculate the hash of this block when you receive it in the network and see if it starts at four zeros. So it only took me three iterations here, but you can imagine if you want to mine a Bitcoin block, it takes quite a bit more, given the energy consumption that is needed. So there are other ways of doing proof of work and proof of stake, but we're not going to cover that in this presentation. So these are a few examples of what hashing is used for. So that's one. So let's move to semantic encryption. So I already told you, in semantic encryption, you have one key that you share between multiple parties, and they can use this key to encrypt and decrypt messages. An example, you have a plain text called DevOx. You put it through this encryption algorithm. You provide it with a key, and out comes a ciphertext. So you can see that this piece of input text has 8 characters. That's not a coincidence. Semantic encryption is mainly block cipher encryption, which means it works on a specific number of bytes or a fixed number of bytes. So this is the simplest example imaginable. You have a string of 8 bytes, and out comes a ciphertext. Provided that you do something like UTF-8, for example, then this would be 8 bytes. This was mentioned in a presentation before I went on stage. So this is data encryption standard. It's quite a bit old. It was invented by IBM. Don't use this anymore, please. There was a contest in 1997 to hack this, and it took them 4 months to actually come up with the original text without having the key. They did it again in 1998. It took them 3 days. They did it again in 1999. It took them 3 hours. So don't use this, please. So what you can use is an encryption algorithm invented by these two guys. These guys are called Johan Dame and Vincent Rijmen. They're Belgian cryptographers. And they won a contest in 1998, I think, with this algorithm. It's called Advanced Encryption Standard. And it's basically the de facto standard in the industry for semantic encryption. So we're going to do a demo of that. But first, let's look how this is implemented in Java. There is a class called Key Generator that has a static method, getInstance. You provide it with the algorithm. And you can call a method generateKey on the instance with a specific key size, for example, 192 bits. Then you can use another class, which is called Cypher, which basically represents the algorithm, and say, OK, I want an instance of this AES. I provide it with a key. I have a message. I can execute a method. It's called do final, but it basically means do the final bit of the encryption. But for simplicity's sake, we'll leave it at that. And out comes the ciphertext. Anyone still in Java 7? Nobody, right? OK, then I'll skip this. Illegal key size was a problem before recent versions of Java 8. But they removed it, and now you can put whatever key size you want in the algorithm, so we'll skip this. So let's see a demo of AES. And I have it here, I think. So this is the first call, key generator. You get an instance of AES. You init it with a key size. You generate a key. I will print this out using a utility function. Then I have an input text, DevOx, repeated 16 times. This is new in Java 11, by the way. So I don't know how we could ever program without this. And so this will be a string, basically 16 times this one, right? Then you have a cipher class, which you can say get instance. You see here AES, that's the algorithm. I will come to this in a moment, what ACB means. And padding is basically if you have a string that is not the exact block size of the algorithm, it will just provide some padding at the end. But I'm not going to go into that today. So you get the encrypted output. I will print this. And then I will reinitialize the cipher again in decrypt mode with the same key. I will take the encrypted output, and I will get back the original input, right? So I'll run this. This is the input. DevOx repeated 16 times. You see the ciphertext here and the decoding here back again. Now, if you look closely, does anything notice you here? Oh, sorry. So there's a repetition in here, right? There's a pattern. It starts all over again here. 0b, 7 times 28. So that's basically because the algorithm works like this. It takes a block of 8 bytes every time, and it puts this through this cryptographic function, and out comes a ciphertext. So a block cipher works basically on chunks. So if your chunk is exactly the same each time, you'll see a pattern emerge, right? Now, this might not be a problem for plain text, but for example, if you try to encode a JPEG, you'll get something like this. So you see a pattern here, and the image is still recognizable. So you don't want this. So one method of combating this is using cipher blockchaining, which is basically saying, okay, I'm going to use the same encryption mechanism, but I'm going to start with a random sequence of numbers. I will combine this with my inputs. Out comes the ciphertext, and I will use, again, this result for the next block. So you can imagine the input for each subsequent block changes every time. So this is a good way to combat patterns and recognition of patterns by cryptoanalysts. If you put this to the algorithm, you will get just static. Nothing will be recognizable anymore. So in Java, this works a little bit different from normal semantic encryption. So you start again with a key generator. You generate a key. And at the same time, you use a class called SecureRandom, which you can use to initialize with an algorithm. And out comes something called an IV parameter spec, which is basically a random sequence of bytes. You get the cipher again. You feed them both into the algorithm. And then it's just encryption and decryption as usual. So the only extra part is the write part on the bit, the bit on the right here. Yeah. So if you put this through the same text through the encryption algorithm, but now with cipher blockchaining, you can see the first part is the same. And I will get a random byte sequence here, get an IV parameter spec, and I will feed them both into the algorithm. Let's see where this actually happens. Yeah, here. So there's an extra parameter here, IV spec. And if I run this, let's see, yeah. So it's the same input text, but now you'll see the ciphertext, and there's no recognizable pattern anymore. So now it looks pseudo-random. So my advice is, when you use semantic encryption, always use a cipher blockchaining mode so you don't get these patterns to be be targeted by cryptoanalysts. So one application is, for example, we'll see an application later on when we look at the HTTPS, but one application is, for example, to encrypt a wallet, for example, a crypto wallet. So you have a plain text password, and you put this to this algorithm called password-based key derivation function. And basically, it's a function to convert your password into a valid AES key. And then you can just encrypt and decrypt your sensitive data, like a wallet or a zip file, as usual. So that's one application of how to use AES in an isolated way. So there's one thing I haven't talked to you about, which is key exchange. So how do you get this key across without anybody noticing? Well, you could put it in a diplomatic mailbag, for example, but that isn't very efficient. So in 1977, these two guys, Martin Hellman and Wilfried Diffie, came up with a brilliant solution to exchange secret keys over an unsecure channel. And it's really, really elegant in its simplicity. So here's how it works. So you have Alice and Bob here. Maybe not the Alice and Bob you expected, but nonetheless, they agree on two numbers, a prime number and a so-called generator. Then they each think of a private number. Alice thinks of 5, Bob thinks of 4. And then they start to calculate a public number that they can exchange over an unsecure channel. So in Alice's case, the public number will be 2. In Bob's case, the public number will be 9. They will exchange this. Anybody can read it, doesn't matter. And they will calculate a shared secret using this formula, shared public to the power private mod p. And out comes a shared secret, and it's always the same on both sides. So they can use this secret key to do semantic encryption. Now you might wonder, well, we have this public key and this one, and the internet knows about this. Doesn't matter. As long as the internet doesn't know about these private parts, you can never guess the shared secrets. Well, this is an easy example because the numbers are really small, but this is a way of exchanging symmetric keys over an unsecure channel, and it's also an example of asymmetric cryptography. which we're going to talk about now. So you've already seen asymmetric cryptography in the beginning as a summary. Bob gets Alice's public key. He uses this to encrypt a message, and Alice can use her private key to encrypt the message again. There are different public key algorithms. We've already seen Diffie-Hellman. That's a key agreement protocol. But you've probably heard about RSA as well. It's another asymmetric encryption algorithm. And for example, elliptic curve cryptography, which is used by blockchain, which is a little bit different because the key size is completely different and the algorithm is different. But these are a few examples of public key algorithms. So how does this work in Java? You have a class called key pair generator, which is not surprising because now you need two keys. You call the static get instance method again, in this example, for example, RSA. I get a key pair, which is basically a container for two keys. I can get a cipher, and then I will initialize it with my private key. I will put my message through, call the do final method again, so to encrypt this message, and out comes the encrypted message. On the other end, if I want to decrypt this, I have to initialize the algorithm with my public key, and out comes my message. So in this case, instead of one key, you need two keys to do it. And it always has to be public-private or private-public, otherwise it won't work. So if I put this through a demo, so I have an asymmetric encryption demo. You see here I have a key pair generator. I will initialize it with a key size. I will generate a key pair, which I will print. And then I have a small piece of input here. It's small with on purpose. I will show you next. I will initialize the algorithm. I'll put it in encrypt mode, and I'll put my private key in it. And then I will do an encryption. And I can decrypt it as well. So I put a public key in and decrypt it, and I will get back my plain text if everything goes OK. So I have another unit test here, which basically is the same, but the text is a little bit longer, so it has a large file, and you will see what happens. So if I run this, oh, where is it? Sorry, that's not the right one. Show me the one that works. Yeah. So you see a private key here, and it's quite long, as you can see. And you see a public key here, which is shorter. So this is an asymmetric algorithm. Keys are not the same length. And here I have the plain text again, so I've decoded it. And if you look at the other unit test, it says I had a really large file with a really large text, the entire Lord of the Rings. It says data must not be longer than 117 bytes. So, you know, how's this work? What do we have to do to make this work? Well, oh, that's not the one. Basically, don't use asymmetric encryption for large blocks of data because it's particularly slow. So that's why there's also a restriction at JDK to say, okay, more than 170 bytes is not going to work because your key has to be like a multitude of almost seven or eight times the bytes of your text. So this is not going to work. But you can use it for agreeing on symmetric keys, what we've seen, encrypting keys. Or, for example, encrypting hashes or message digests, because they're always small, they're always a fixed size. So that's where digital signatures come in. So if you look at digital signatures, we've seen confidentiality, because we now can encrypt a block of text and nobody knows what it is, but not integrity, because anyone can just change the encrypted text and out comes a completely different plain text. That's not what you want. So you will also want to make sure the data is untampered. So that's what digital signatures are for. So you can do this with symmetric encryption. It's called AMAC. I'm going to skip that for a moment now. Otherwise, I don't have the time. But this is the most common use case, a digital signature using asymmetric encryption. So what happens here is you have a piece of message, you put it to a digest, and then you sign the digest with a private key, or you encrypt the digest with a private key. You send the encrypted digest, the message, and the public key to the receiving end. They can take the digest and decrypt it with the public key, and out comes a certain value. Then they proceed to calculate the hash of the original message. So if this is a value X, and this has a value X as well, you know the message has not been tampered with, right? So this is a way of guaranteeing integrity. In Java, you have a key pair generator again, where you generate a key pair, and then there's a class called signature, which you can use for this. So this does both tasks, encryption and hashing. You don't have to hash yourself. You init with a private key, and then you put through your message, you say sign, and out comes a signature instead of an encrypted message. On the other side, the receiving end, you can initialize the algorithm with a key pair, with the public key. You can put the message through the signature algorithm again, and the function will tell you if the signature is correct. So there's no text that comes out again, or no byte array. It just has Boolean. It says, okay, this signature matches up with the one that was in the message. So I'll give a demo of that. Let's see, simple signing demo. Yeah. So the first part is the same again. I have a key pair generator. I use it to initialize a key. I generate a key pair. I have a piece of data here. And now I'm going to sign this message. So I have a signature, get instance. And now you see there's a combination of hashing and asymmetric encryption. So I say you have to calculate the digest with SHA-256 and encrypt it with RSA. So then I'm going to initialize the algorithm with my private key. I will feed it my data. So this is basically the bytes from this string. And I will say sign, and out comes the signature. So now I have the signature. I can verify on the other hand, on the receiving party, that this signature is valid. So I will create the same verification algorithm. I will say, okay, go to verify mode with the public key, which I already got from the receiving end, because you send them in the same message. And I will update the algorithm with the data from the actual message. DevOx is the best. And out comes if the signature matches. So the hashing and the comparing is all done here. You don't have to do this yourself. So yeah, if I run this, you can see, okay, there's a signature length. This is the signature, the actual signature. And it has length of 128 bytes. And of course, because I put in the same signature here, the signature does not match. So let's see what happens if I put something else in. So this is, let's see, what is this? Byte array, so something this. So everybody agrees on this is a different signature, right? So now it fails. Oh, okay, it even says now signature length not correct. Okay, so it first validates this before even trying to do a compare, but you get the idea what's happening here. So that's how digital signatures work. So an application of digital signature is in crypto transactions, for example, where if Alice wants to initiate a transaction to Bob, for example, she wants to send 100 of whatever that is, I don't know, to Bob. She will make a transaction and then will sign this transaction with her private key. She will then proceed to send the signature, her public key, and the transaction over the network. It will be received by a node in the blockchain, or to Bob, if he has a node. And from there, the signature can be verified. So does the signature, when decrypted with the public key, it produces a hash, and does this match the hash of the message? Are these the same? Then the signature is okay. You can be sure that Alice is the one who actually sent this message. It has been untampered with, and then the transaction is authenticated. So this is an example of using digital signatures in cryptocurrency. So that's digital signatures. And now I have one last bit, and that's about certificates. So now we've seen confidentiality, we've seen integrity, and what about authenticity? So how do I know that someone who sends me his or her public key is actually the person I want to speak with? So that's where digital signatures come in. So what basically happens is, if I want to prove that I am who I say I am, I have to create a private public key pair, and I send the public key along with some credentials for myself, for example, identification or passport or whatever, to this thing called a certificate authority, which basically says, okay, we've checked you out and you are indeed who you say you are, so you will get back a certificate which says, hereby certificate authority XYZ to hereby certify that this person is he or she claims to be and this public key is this. And you can trust this certificate authority. Why? We'll see in a moment. So how does this work? If you want to have a certificate, you have to create a CSR. It's called a certificate request. So this basically means a certificate request is your public key along with some credentials from you. It will be checked by the certificate authority, and they will create a certificate for you that makes this statement that you are who you say you are, and it's signed by their private key, so you know the public key is in the certificate, so you know that the certificate authority is actually the person who signed the certificate, because they have to be trusted as well. So you can probably see where this is going. So how do I know that I can trust those guys? Well, those guys also have a certificate, which is signed by another party again, and so on and so on. But of course, this has to end somewhere, right? So this last certificate authority on the bottom, well, you have to trust them implicitly, because the cycle has to end somewhere. So they basically authorize or authenticate themselves. So you can see this, for example, in this is our website for Craftsman. And I don't know if I can zoom this in, but I'll try and walk you through it. It says here, this is a certificate issued to Craftsman NL. Well, I will do it like this. To Craftsman NL, and it's issued by a certificate authority, SECTIGO. I don't know exactly what it is. But this is basically the certificate provider that signed my certificate. And if you look at the path, you see here that there's another one. So I can click here, and it's the same thing. So this is issued by another one, and that's the one on the top. And you can see here, it is issued to this root certificate authority, and it's issued by themselves. So this is a self-signed certificate. This is always the end of the line. So what happens if a security authority is compromised? So this actually happened in the Netherlands. It was a company called DigiNotar. It was around 2005, I think. And this was a root certificate authority, and they were hacked and their private keys were stolen. So that meant each security issued by these guys or issued transitively by these guys was suddenly worthless, because anyone could now create a DigiNotar security certificate. So all companies in the Netherlands that use DigiNotar certificates, notably a few large banks, had to throw away all their certificates and issue new ones, for example, by VeriSign or Google or another trusted certificate authority. So the implicit trust or explicit trust that was given to these guys was completely destroyed, and they went bankrupt in the same year. So this was a huge disaster in the Netherlands, to give an idea of how brittle this chain might be. Thankfully, creating a certificate in standard Java is a bit of a hassle. You can use, for example, the Bouncy Castle security provider for that. It's much easier. But it is easier to store and manage certificates. So there is an interface called Java Key Store in Java, which basically gives you the opportunity to write certificates and private keys to files and get them out again. It's very easy to use. So there's a link at the end of this presentation that will include a link to the demo, and there's also a Java Key Store demo there, so you can look it up. Generating certificates is a pain, but frankly, there's a tool in the JDK called KeyTool, which you can use to generate key pairs, generate certificate requests to send to these certificate authorities, and also, for example, exporting certificates, stuff like that. It's all in there. It's really easy to use. So don't try to generate certificates programmatically yourself, because KeyTool is much easier. So those were the five subjects I wanted to talk to you about today. I have one thing left, which is HTTPS, where all these things come together. So this is normally not something you would look at, but it's interesting to see what actually happens. So this is the handshake of a HTTPS request. So what happens here? This is the first step. A client says hello to the server before establishing an HTTPS request, and it will negotiate what algorithm they will use. So that can be Diffie-Hellman. We've seen already this, or RSA. And if they agree on a set of protocols, the server will send a certificate back to the client. The client will validate the certificates, checking the digital signature using their public key. And then it will proceed to come up with a random number. It's called a master secret. And it will encrypt it with the public key of the server. Or they can use Diffie-Hellman Exchange. It depends on what algorithm they chose a little bit earlier. So the server will decrypt this with their private key or Diffie-Hellman Exchange. And from there on, they both have the same number. They can use this to generate an AES key and then start to use AES encryption. So this is a nice example, HTTPS, to see how all these different concepts of cryptography come together in the HTTPS handshake. So my original plan was a takeaway of a basic understanding of cryptographic concepts and how they're done in Java. I hope I succeeded at that. And thank you very much. If you want to play around with the examples, you can use this GitHub project. All the examples are in there, including more intricate examples like key stores and Bitcoin blockchain mining, stuff like that. And that's all there is to it. So thank you very much. Well, we actually have 8 minutes left, really. So any questions? Absolutely no one. Okay. I'm glad I was so clear. If you have any questions or you think of any questions afterwards, please feel free to come up to me and ask any question you want, okay? So thank you very much for attending this talk and enjoy the rest of the conference.